one. Professor Devine, you made reference to a case which you had given expert evidence to in relation to Perth Sheriff Court. Did that relate to football?
No, it was an incident that took place in one of these in small towns, Scotland, or maybe is Perth a city? I don't know.
It is, I think it is.
At 2 o'clock on, I think it was 2 days after Christmas last year, one of the defendants was an off-duty policeman, and one of the accusers was also an off-duty policeman, so it was a very interesting case. It had nothing whatsoever to do with being present at a football match. It was unambiguously a breach of the peace, but the more interesting and, if you like, nice question was it sectarian aggravated? The assistant or deputy law, prosecutor, the deputy, the assistant procurator fiscal argued strongly that it was, and so strongly indeed that the sheriff started to lose in patience with her, because, you know, the case was the Irish Republican Army is a sectarian anti-Protestant organisation, therefore singing about it is sectarian aggravated in terms of section 74 of the 2003 legislation. Historically, that statement cannot be proven. That's not to say that that organisation has killed Protestants. Of course it has, but it's also killed Catholics. And it's a politically motivated terrorist organisation.
Thank you.
Yes, I'm just checking with one of the members for Perth. It's not a city unit, is it? I've allowed you to say that. You're in part of the campaign. Just to clarify, if the Perth people could be offended there. Alison, followed by Hamza, and...
Thanks, Convener. Professor Devine, would you think it would be folly to go ahead with this legislation without seeing that evidence that you're talking about, that analysis?
Correct. Yeah. Because, I mean, let's create the theoretical hypothetical. And I'm not necessarily saying this will come out, but some of the analysis done by, I think, the Holy Roman Catholic Church has suggested that the 2003 data showed that Catholics are more likely to be targeted six times in the ratio of six times to non-Catholics. Now, they may not have produced this evidence on the basis of social scientific rigorous inquiry. I don't know how they came to that figure. But supposing for the sake of the hypothetical, you find that that figure is replicated in the massive database from 2003 to the present, we have an issue. We have a huge issue in this society to deal with. And we may well have to consider whether Keith O'Brien, the Cardinal Archbishop of Glasgow, was right when he asserted this is not a sectarian problem, it is blatant anti-Catholicism. We don't have the evidence he may have, but I don't have, to support that assertion. But we will know a lot more when the entrails of these data are considered and explored.
Thank you.
Anyone else wishes to comment? So I now have Hamza, please.
On that note, actually, if there is, it's often said, and there was submission by HARPS community group that came in that, and I think I can agree with this to an extent, is that anti-Catholic and anti-Irish bigotry is sometimes lost in the framework of sectarianism. Therefore, it's not important and imperative that we avoid categorising sectarianism in the bill, and therefore having these categories of colour, race, nationality in particular are therefore very important.
I profoundly disagree with you.
What
because
reason?
I disagree with you because the essence of the problem, if you like, the casus belli, the reason for war, that produced this process were the incidents relating to perceived sectarian behaviour during the last football season. What is the logical reason, therefore, for spreading the legislation? I mean, one of the toughest areas and most robust areas of offensive behaviour is anti-race legislation. You know, we have that at the moment. I go back to the intellectual conundrum. Why did the legal officers wish to extend this into other areas? Other areas perhaps of some legitimate concern, but areas particularly which are controversial, ambiguous, and with the legal process could perhaps even end up looking like an ass.
Is it not the point, just to follow up on that then, I mean, the legislation in the beginning is very clearly dealing with incitement to public disorder and a behaviour that would likely to incite public disorder. And when it comes to sectarianism, many anti-Irish behaviour many of those people believe that their Irishness, in a sense, is part of their race rather than their nationality. So
their identity.
Part of their identities. And therefore, the police were very robust in saying that they don't feel that current measures are able to deal with that. You just think it's the police are being too lazy.
What explanation did they give for that statement?
For the
fact that the current measures are inadequate.
Well, they thought that causing fear and alarm wasn't addressed. The test for breach of the peace being causing fear and alarm, they thought was not addressed. And they thought, for example, if you go into a supporters club, a pub, then there's nobody there that's caused fear or alarm, so therefore they couldn't go in with breach of the peace.
That's your analysis.
That was their analysis.
That was their analysis, right. You've reported their analysis. My analysis is different, because my analysis is that the moving the goalposts into political provocation and ethnic provocation, etc., moves away from the case, which is very relatively easy to prove because of statements made, messages sent, songs sung, which is religious hatred.
Can I just ask a question for clarification, that the statistics that we're looking at with the Criminal Justice Scotland Act 2003 that we're requesting and how these are analysed, is it the case that Celtic fans sing songs that say are pro-IRA and that could be deemed political, whereas Rangers are singing songs which would be seen as being sectarian? And that might slew the statistics, in that it might be difficult, therefore, to prosecute Celtic supporters under this Act, because its offence is aggravated by religious prejudice.
You're absolutely right. You could not use it for that purpose. And that was the reason why the case was thrown out in Perth.
Because
the sheriff decided that these were, statements of political loyalty or racial loyalty.
Therefore, statistics based on this, which you say is sufficient, along with other existing law, whether in statute or in common law, and we therefore don't need the first part of this bill, these statistics will not prove your point about sectarianism going both ways, because this Act doesn't tackle sectarianism in terms of what Celtic are doing.
It's relevant to the issue in terms of the single criterion of religious hatred, okay? And if you go back to your statement about songs being sung by Rangers supporters, I would say probably the overwhelming majority of those songs are not relevant to the Act. But there are some which are. And if you wish the list, I'm sure UEFA would be able to provide that, because there's actually only a very small minority of them that would fit under, that would be capable of being arraigned before the 2003 Act. My concern is to try and deal with this problem, or at least approach to dealing with this problem that we have in Scotland through this legal process. We all agree that it'll take a large number of other influences to produce a result over time. My sense is that what is being proposed moves away from the key problem. But it's only a point of view.
Yes, I know, we accept that. I'd be interested once we get these stats. Can I just say, if you're accepting my premise then, that in terms of this existing legislation 2003, that prosecutions under this will be more successful, Rangers supporters singing, notwithstanding the point that they're not all sectarian songs, than Celtic supporters singing or behaving in a certain way or chanting, because that would not be deemed to be sectarian, more likely to be political.
Yes, but I mean, I quite honestly don't understand the point you're making. It may not be even in terms of this proposed legislation.
No.
But it's even in terms of the 2003 Act, which only deals with, quote, religious hatred, unquote. You can't honestly consider the statistical evidence to be dealing with anything other than the processes of law involved in the interpretation of that Act.
sorry, I'm not explaining myself clearly. I want to forget all the other categories in the offensive behaviour bill. I want to go back to this, the 2003 Act, which is offences aggravated by religious prejudice. And the point I'm asking you to address is prosecutions are more likely to take place, it's just a proposition, of range of supporters and their behaviour and singing because what they're doing may be deemed to be sectarian, whereas Celtic supporters and what they're singing and chanting and doing is more likely to deal with the IRA to be deemed to be political, therefore will not fall within the ambit of Section 74.
Well, the issue here is that only a small minority of the cases that I have cited took place in or around football matches. The rest of them took place, obviously, in the street. Drink had been taken in many instances, etc., etc. And the issue, therefore, in terms of the background of victims and assailants, is nothing to do in terms of the legislation or the data from the legislation. There's nothing to do with a person's football affiliation. It's to do with their religion, right? Yeah. And the religious evidence suggests, in terms of the Crown Office conclusion, there were twice as many Catholic as Protestant victims in the cases examined. 1% of the cases showed Muslims as being the target. Now, for reasons I'm not absolutely certain about, the Catholic Bishop of Motherwell concluded in an article about 6 months after these data appeared that Catholics were more likely to be six times greater as victims. I don't know what he based that on. All I'm saying to you is there is very interesting information coming down the track, and I think certainly, as one of the committee members suggested, it would be quite useful if the committee could consider those results in due course before this legislation goes very much further.
Well, on that point, in fact, we're not masters of the timetable, but we're doing our very best. We are not masters of parliamentary timetable, regrettably. We may have some room, very slight room for manoeuvre. I have to check that with the clerks. Mr. Dean, you want to comment on this, and then I'm going to leave it,
okay,
because the question's
okay
there and the answer's there.
No, I recognise the point you are making, and I think what we have to do is recognise that in some cases you have to show that what may be seen as a political category or